I love the old sticks behind you. I'm zooming in closer. That's why I'm looking at my screen closer. Where did you find each of these? Were these gifts? Were these flea market finds? How? Where did you get this collection of great sticks?
Well, they are all, I don't know if you, how many you can see, but they're all made by Elfie Jocks. So okay. I've got them all from the Onondagas, and he does a great job. They're fun. The first one I got for my son when he graduated from, I think, high school. And then okay. I liked it so much, I never really gave it to him. So,
hey, he moved out. You kept the stick. No problem.
That's right.
And is that your Eagle Scout?
That is my Eagle Scout.
Coincidentally, I'm rocking the Cub Scout pack 160.
I like that
tonight. My son and I just are working on his Parvuli Day stuff. That's the
oh, good for you.
Religious emblem for his fourth graders. So I didn't realize you were an Eagle. Very cool.
Yeah, and I'm a Parvuli Day instructor. I think. I mean, I haven't done it obviously for a long time, but.
Wow. Yeah, I'm the religious emblems coordinator for our pack, and actually I'm helping out some other packs too that are not part of a religious group. So, you know, us crazy Catholics, we like to put our nose right in everything. So I want to share my screen and get some small talk, but a chance for you to brag first. I saw this week, if you can see my screen, this tweet. That yeah. Some kid from, of all places, Brighton, Michigan, committed to play at Harvard. I mean, that doesn't happen every day, every year, that a kid from Brighton commits to Harvard. Do you want to brag for a minute and talk about your kid?
Well, we have a lot of really great kids, and this is one that's really exciting. John's a great player. He's done really well with the Cherries. He's the starting quarterback on our football team, and we're really excited for him. I think he's going there. Carson Billig from our team has committed to U of M. And we have other commits as well. I think Will Johnson is going to Siena, and Carson's brother Drew is at UND. And so we've had some guys going on to the next level. We got guys at Michigan State and Elma and Albion, and but this one's pretty cool. I mean, I'm a big fan of that coach.
Yeah,
watched all of the Notre Dame videos, and I'm now following the Harvard videos, and they're just really cool. So I'm excited for him. I hope it all works out for him.
That's really cool. Yeah, I saw that, and Lacrosse Twitter's a great spot for finding recruits and where everyone's going and what's going on. So I saw that pop up and went, geez, I know that you've had some good players and good teams and good recruits, but Harvard's Harvard, man. That's
big. Yeah, that's,
congratulations to John.
Yeah, John's going there, and we've got one going to U of M. And, there's a lot of kids that we've seen, even within our own league, that are headed to U of M. So
yeah.
Michigan is doing a really good job at recruiting and getting some of the best talent coming out of Michigan.
So is Heartland in your league?
Yeah.
Okay, so I know Lockwood's going up there.
Lockwood's going there. I think Lauterbach is headed there. I'm not sure about that. He's the faceoff kid from Northville, but I think he committed there a long time ago. He's an amazing athlete. I watched him in football this year, and he's fun to watch.
Awesome. So I know that Cherries today had a play date, and a bunch of teams came up from Indy, Kansas City, as well as Illinois. I reffed yesterday when they were down at Adrian College with the Omnia guys and had a play day there. I'm happy to report that after not reffing for 7 months and being a completely out of shape referee,
right,
I did all six games. My iWatch said I did 14 plus miles, and I survived, and I can kind of walk today. So lacrosse is back.
Yeah, I've been having practices, and I'm certainly out of shape. I mean, just doing what I do, which isn't a whole lot to begin with, you're pretty exhausted in the first 10 minutes of those practices. So, yeah I can imagine.
We got six games in each. It was me, Bill Schmidt, and Josh Pate went down there to ref them, and it was a blast. Omnia, Adrian was fantastic hosts. That's an amazing campus and facility for the MIAA. So it was a lot of fun down there.
I've played there a couple times.
Yeah. And Coach Wenzel is great there. And DCAT over at Omnia was a great host. And all those teams, some great competition. No knuckleheads. I think we had maybe 1 3-minute penalty the entire day in 9 games, and it was a frustration cheap shot, but everyone was just trying to play, get some touches in before they go off to their big recruiting events in the near future.
Yeah. That's fun to see kids playing for sure.
Yeah, there was some really good talent out there. The funny thing is, next weekend, I'm taking my son down to Indiana with Omnia. He's on their U10 team, and for the first time since 1989, I will be attending a tournament as not a player, not a coach, and not a referee. I'll be attending as a dad and a fan. So I get to go down there, and I'm going to get my little red solo cup, and I'm going to sit in my lawn chair, and I'm going to yell, "Wheels!" every time my kid gets the ball. And I will do all I can to yell at other parents when they yell, "Helmet!" and everything else. But I am so
if you need any pointers on how to yell at the refs, I know a few guys that I can.
Do I you? Can, yeah, right. I think you might. Well, which kind of is a good transition into the topic of the night. You are, we didn't introduce you, but Jim Carl, head coach Brighton High School, president of the Michigan High School Scholastic Lacrosse Coaches Association. Did I get that alphabet of, or is it the Michigan
School? It's close. It's the Michigan High School Lacrosse Coaches Association.
I was close. So you're the president of the Coaches Association, you're the head coach at Brighton, and you are also on the MHSAA Lacrosse Committee that every year sets certain things like regional selections, regional regions, teams, assignments, state championship teams, All-American nominations, and now COVID planning for 2021. Right. So
kind of right. So
that's who you are.
Yeah. The committee is constituted by the MHSAA. The All-American is a whole separate thing. The MHSAA, to my knowledge, has nothing to do with any postseason awards. Those are all driven through each sport's individual associations. I do gotcha. The American because I'm the U.S. Lacrosse High School Area Chair.
Gotcha.
So I serve a lot of different roles, but the All-American and the All-State are not really tied into the MHSAA. That's why you see with the All-State stuff, we've made a number of different changes and flip-flop. We could probably not do that with the MHSAA. We do it. It's more member-driven.
Gotcha.
Than anything else. The MHSAA committee is, I can't remember how many people are on it, but there's about 10 people on it, and people are selected to be on it for 2-year terms.
Gotcha.
So not everybody, it's got a staggered membership. So as you know, a couple people are leaving or half the group is leaving, another new half is coming in, so that in any given year, you have had some people that have experience in that role.
So while there is some carryover between the Coaches Association leadership and the MHSAA committee, you're still acting in two separate roles in the two different organizations.
Yeah, and I'm on that committee as a representative of the Coaches Association.
Gotcha.
I'm there necessarily as a coach. I've been invited to be there. I think that's pretty standard for in all of these, you know, each sport has this committee, and I think the president of every association is defaulted to be a member of that committee.
Gotcha. Okay. So let's jump into why I reached out and asked you to be on here tonight. I'm going to share my screen again. This okay. was from October 14th. So what is today? Today is the 18th. So this would have been Thursday. There was a tweet put out by our friend Chris Garland over at Country Day and Juice Cherries, and he has a screenshot of the MHSAA committee minutes that says, playing rule modifications due to COVID-19, face-off elimination in 2021. So the way that this reads, the committee reviewed a list of possible modifications to playing rules and officials' mechanics. Among those adopted were extending the players' and coaches' boxes to the end line to ensure proper safe social distancing, limiting table personnel and official pregame meetings and stick check mechanics, which will be clarified closer to the season. The committee did not accept the recommendation that the varsity game times be reduced to 10-minute quarters. Several other protocols will be clarified closer to the season, including the use of clear, molded, and non-rigid face shields. The committee extensively discussed face-offs in the NFHS recommendation to reduce face-offs to 2 per game. At the beginning of the first and third quarters, the committee determined that at the present time, in lieu of this protocol, the following shall be the rule and mechanic under COVID-19 protocols for all member schools in 2021. And I want to read that last line again, because this is where I think everyone freaked out. The committee determined that at the present time, in lieu of this protocol, the following shall be the rule and mechanic under COVID-19 protocols for MHSAA member school lacrosse teams in 2021. Use of an alternating possession will be implemented as an alternative to conducting a face-off in boys lacrosse for the spring of 2021. Initial possession will be determined by the pregame coin toss, with the winner having the option of accepting possession at the start of the game or deferring to the second half. I don't need to get through the rest of this, because I think that last line of the first paragraph, the committee determined that at the present time, in lieu of this protocol, the following shall be the rule mechanic under COVID 2019 protocols for MHSAA member lacrosse schools in 2021. This made it look like 2021, if and when we have a season, no face-offs. And when Garland saw this, he took a snapshot of it, tweeted it. The committee has adopted these changes for the 2021 season. This meeting notes make that clear. This is a huge change to our game. I was freaking out myself. I tweeted at Garland and said, this makes no sense. There's no science behind this. How can offensive and defensive linemen engage but face-off kids can't? How can we have walls in soccer where they're physically touching each other and these kids can't through their gloves and their sticks? How can we have corner kicks in soccer with 15 people jostling around? How can we have a tip-off in basketball? Like, why is our sport being attacked? And it seemed, as I read this tweet, that they are deciding on October 17th, 2020, that this is what's going to be the rule come March 2021. So I'll take a breath and just say, I reached out to you. Well, actually, I think we were in a Facebook conversation, and then Doug Jolly, I didn't say Mike's name on Twitter, but Doug Jolly reached out to me on behalf of his dad, because his dad, Mike, who's on the committee, was out in Colorado with him, and said, no, Druin, Doug, you need to tell Druin this is not what's going on. Turns out these are all suggestions. There's another meeting in January, but we didn't know this, and when the cat was out of the bottle, and I'm showing this thing, there were 38 quote tweets on this from everybody from Greg Gerinlian from the PLL and the Faceoff Academy, to Mike Gerinlian, his brother, to coaches in Indiana, to coaches in Ohio, to, you know, all these people, college coaches. Everyone was freaking out as if this was now gospel, and that we're coming to take the face-off out of the game, and Michigan's the first ones that do it, and darn it, we're doing it under COVID as our excuse, was the way that I read Twitter. I want to shut up and give you a chance to kind of clear the air and say, what's going on, what are we doing, and what did we screw up, what did we get right?
Well, without being negative to anybody, I think that most of what was in the social media world was not an accurate reflection of what happened in the meeting and what was decided. You know, yeah. I'll just throw that out there. I can only tell you, I was as confused. And then when I went in and read what you just read, I said, well, gosh, maybe we did. Maybe I missed something. Maybe I fell asleep in that meeting, because that's not what I did. So I reached out to a couple people on the committee. And yesterday I had an opportunity to communicate with Tom Rashid to say, before I go into an interview, I need to know exactly what it is. So I'm going to kind of give you a breakdown of what we did and what the committee does so that people can understand it.
So, and I really appreciate, as you jump into this, because I think that committee and the MHSAA sometimes get vilified as they're not lacrosse people, when the committee is all lacrosse people, or they're not, you know, they're behind closed doors and there's some secret society out to just make money and screw people. I think that this is a chance, clear the air as far as anything you want to talk about, the committee, this meeting, this rule, All of the above. Go for it.
Okay. So here's the way that all of this came down. We get together, and there are a number of rules that are proposed by the National Federation. And it's the Federation that establishes the rules that we follow in high school. So the rules you're reffing come from the National Federation. And the Federation had, I think there were 8 or 9 different proposed rules that we would implement if we were in COVID restriction.
Yeah. So everyone knows it's the NFHS, the National Federation for High Schools, that issues the lacrosse rulebook for high school sports every year. It's not the MHSAA. It's not U.S. Lacrosse. It's NFHS. That is the rules committee. Sorry, go ahead.
Yeah, that's right. And so I want to read just verbatim what, as a committee, we were looking at. Because I don't want to get it wrong. I think it's really relevant. I'm just trying to go through my papers to find it. So the sixth proposal that we were given by the NFHS, and this is how it reads. Consider only performing the faceoff during the beginning of the game and at the beginning of the third quarter. If necessary, at the beginning of all overtime play. If reduced faceoffs is implemented, then alternating possessions shall be used. And as a committee, we said, well, wait a minute. This completely changes everything. And what does it even mean? There's no definition there at all. So let's say we go to alternate possessions. And I don't want to bore you with all of the discussion. I don't even know if I can remember it. But, you know, let's start with alternating possessions. What does that even mean? Does that mean that if it is it like basketball where there's an arrow? If I score and the arrow is pointed at me, do I then automatically get the ball? And if I do, where do I get it? Do I have to go down to the defensive end? Do I get it behind the goal? Do I get it outside the box? Do I get it at the restraining line? And, or alternatively to that, if I score, you get the ball. Well, where do you get the ball? And so I said, the committee said, we need to define how this rule would be implemented. I mean, if it got bad enough that we had to do this, then what are the game competition logistics? Because those are really important. And I think coaches and players need to be able to prepare for the worst case scenario. And I think we needed to be in a language so that, it, you know, reflective of that NFHS rule book that you just showed.
Yeah.
I got to tell you that on the committee, there were a number of different, you know, positions about what should happen. I mean, one of the positions offered was if I score on you, your team gets the ball at midfield on a free clear. And I said, well, wait a minute. Now we're getting rid of both the faceoff and the ride? I mean, that doesn't make any sense. So at the end of the day, we agreed that this is the worst case scenario. It's a horrible rule. And there are too many unanswered questions about how it would figure in a game. And there are too many entities that are not represented. Most importantly, we didn't have any refs on this committee. And so we said, let's table this motion. And let's, as a committee, go out between now and January and talk to people in the lacrosse community. Let's talk to other head coaches at other schools. Let's talk to athletic directors. Let's be the brains of those coaches that are involved in a summer program. We've got a lot of colleges in Michigan that are going to be going through some of the same things that we're going through this coming season. And let's figure out, number one, if we are there other better solutions that maintain the integrity of the game? Because this rule is absolutely horrible. Yeah. It's a starting point, but if this is the best we can do, we're in big trouble. But you know, I also think in the lacrosse community, we can reach out on a national level. One of the guys that I wanted to reach out to was the guy from the Faceoff Academy. I don't know him, but I know he's really responsive.
He posted a video responding to this rule within an hour of him reading it.
And I thought his idea was really good. I mean, I like the way the PLL did it. I mean, they had a pretty successful season, and nobody had to touch the ball. At the end of the day, we said, this rule is horrible. If we get to this, and remember, COVID protocols began at the time where we were canceling the season. Like last year, so we picked up where we left last year, and we left last year with a cancellation. And I don't want to pick on Chris, but in that tweet you just showed, he said, if this is the way we're going to do it, we just can't play lacrosse in Michigan in the spring. And my argument to that would be, if I could go back to the class of 2020 and say, hey, you guys have really been raked over the coals, and we have two options. We can cancel the season, or we can play under this miserable set of rules. I don't think there's anybody in the coaching level or on the playing level that wouldn't have said, let's play ball. Let's play these rules. And that's kind of where we were at. But we also said, we don't want to be there. And we want to take the experience that fall sports, you know, primarily football, because it's the other high risk sport. Let's take some measures and put them in place to see if we can, there are alternative ways to deal with the COVID virus. Could we use face guards or face shields? Could we do face off guys with both face shields and PPE or face masks? Can we get face masks for the referees? I mean, there's all kinds of, there are thousands of better ways than this, but nobody really had those to bring to the table. So we said, let's go out and do some work. Let's talk to people. Let's get together. And in January, a little bit closer to the season, with a little bit better sense of where we are in relation to the virus, and let's find a way that we can have lacrosse as close to its the way that it's always been played, and preferably in ways that maintain the integrity of the game.
And Jim, I really am happy that you kind of went through some of that, and it's one of the reasons why I reached out to you to ask you to hop on this, because the way that you worded it originally was to me, look, Chris, we have to have a season, all right? The 2020 kids got screwed. We have to do whatever we can to make sure we have a 2021 season. And you said, and it starts now. Wash your hands. Wear your mask. Do whatever it takes to whether or not you believe or disbelieve or think masks work. Don't just, we know what the new social norms are. We know what the expectations are. Do it now. Let's get through football. Let's get through winter sports. Let's make sure that we're doing everything we can so that we get to have a season in 2021. And darn it, if we are having an outbreak or we are having issues or we are having restrictions, let's throw everything on the table. Let's look at every possible option up to and unfortunately including eliminating the face-off if we have to, just to make sure we have a season. So, again, I think the way that Twitter melted down, because the way it was written, sounded like we aren't waiting to see anything. We're not waiting to do anything. We're just going to cancel the face-off now because, you know, as the Twitter world melted down, they just want to get rid of the face-off in Michigan. And the reality is nobody in that room has anything against the face-off, wants to get rid of the face-off, wants to do anything to change it. It's just if we ever have to have the conversation about what do we need to change to make sure we still get a 2021 season, let's get ahead of the ball on it. And let's start having those conversations now in the fall of 2020.
100%. And I can only speak to my perspective. I can't really talk to what everybody was going through everybody else's mind. But I've watched all of your podcasts. And I follow, you know, I'm in social media as much as I want to be. And back in March, when we were canceling the season, we were delaying the season, right?
Yeah.
The noise, and some of this came from your podcast. You know, what is the plan? What's the backup plan? What are we doing if the date is April 15th? What are we doing if it's April 30th? Is there a way for us to get the playoffs? You know, it appeared to people that nobody was doing anything. And I can tell you that nothing could be further from the truth. I mean, I know for a fact that the team in place at the MHSAA was working on a daily basis and changing their plans as the virus knowledge of the virus changed, the executive orders changed. You know, I mean, there's so much that was changing sometimes by the hour. And the one thing that I learned listening and reading the podcast and the social media is that people in the want some transparency. And so I decided, hey, let's be transparent right now. Let's tell people what we're thinking and what we're doing so that if it comes to this in March, we're not catching anybody by surprise. In the meantime, let's work really hard to make sure this does not happen. This is a horrible rule. And we may be able to tweak it, but if you only tweak this rule, you end up with a little less horrible of a rule to put in place. So that's kind of where I'm at. I got to plug this computer in, Chris, so I got to come out of the screen for just a second.
Yeah, and so I guess I'll share with you and everyone else, you know, kind of what my Thursday looked like, because I'm doing my job. I'm a Sandler sales trainer by day, and I'm doing my trainings, and I'm doing my selling and all that stuff. And I see this tweet, and like I said, I responded to it the same way, you know, and it was me, John Paul, Garland, handful of the people that were like, this is ridiculous. Like, how can you can have a jump ball in basketball, but we can't have a face-off? Like, this is at, like, we thought it was the MHSAA's decision, not a committee decision. And so for like the rest of the afternoon, I got no work done. I had an hour-long phone call with Brian Effinger. I had some conversations back and forth with you. I had some conversations back and forth with some other people that had reached out to me to see what I had heard. And I put on my Columbo detective hat, and I got to work calling people and reaching out to people. And there were all these conversations going on around, because I took the tweet, the snapshot of it, and I sent it to the MHLOA board, the Michigan Lacrosse Officials Association. And this was before I knew who the committee was. So let me share my screen again. I had thought at the time that the MHSAA made the decision, not the committee. So when I sent this snapshot to our board, which is Jim Hebden, Guy Belmare, Josh Pate, and Ed Ray, I copied our assigner, Bill Schmidt, I copied our trainer, Brian Effinger, and said, was anybody in this meeting? Does anybody know what just happened? How and why did we get rid of the face-off? And did they not want to talk to the officials about how we might actually have to adjudicate this in games now? Nobody had heard from any of us. This was before I had talked to you, and you had specifically said, no, we're going to meet again in January with officials, with, you know, community healthcare leaders, with coaches and ADs and everything else. And so when I went to the MHSAA site, I found the committee notes or members. I'm sorry, this was the committee meeting. This was the notes that Rash had recorded. So I want to go through the team list. So Steve, is it pronounced Irie?
I think it's Ayer. I think it's Ayer. I'm sorry.
Okay. So he's the head coach of Tecumseh High School Lacrosse.
Yep.
You're the head coach at Brighton and represents the Coaches Association. Rick de Blasio, East Grand Rapids. He's the head coach there.
Yep.
Bob Dowd, former coach at Detroit Country Day, current athletic director, Troy Athens.
Right.
Always been a lacrosse guy, always been around. I don't know if he still is, but at one point he was on the NFHS rules committee, that page of who was on the committee. So he's been involved in this stuff for a while. Rich Kimball, former D1 coach, Michigan State, current head coach, Lansing Catholic Central. Chris Riker, Portage Northern. I don't know Chris. I assume he's a coach, athletic director.
I think Chris is an athletic director.
Okay. Ray Miller, Canton Plymouth, he's the coach there.
No, he's not. He's actually an athletic director.
Okay.
He had to give up his coaching position, and he's now the athletic director at Plymouth.
Wait, he went from lacrosse coach to athletic director?
He did, and he couldn't coach both. So, you know, but he was coach of the year for U.S. lacrosse a couple years ago.
Yeah, very recently.
Yeah, just –
So he pulled an Aaron Frank, huh?
He went
from head coach to 80.
That's a good way to put it. He did.
All right. And then Nicole Morris from the MIAA.
Yeah.
That's the Michigan.
The athletic director.
Yeah. That's the athletic directors.
Yeah, I think that's what the MIAA is.
Yeah, because the MIAA is the conference I'm thinking of.
Yeah,
and
I think it's
Kevin Wolma from Hudsonville. I don't know who that is.
Yeah, I think that, yeah.
Michigan Interscholastic Athletic Administrators Association.
Yeah.
Administrators Association. Okay. And then Kevin Wolma from Hudsonville, I don't know. And then Cole and Tom from the MHSAA. We all know Tom Rasch. And actually, I talked with Tom briefly by email on Thursday. he was going in for a little procedure, and, you know, he's an old Catholic guy. I'm a Catholic guy, so I told him I'd say a prayer to St. Luke for him. St. Luke's the patron saint of all the physicians and for the sick, if you didn't know. So I just want to reach out and let him know I was thinking about him. So it says Hudsonville Athletic Director Kevin Wilma. So he's the AD of Hudsonville. So you have lacrosse people in the room. The committee is lacrosse people.
I think it is. I mean, I don't really constitute it, but as I look at it, you've got Division One and Division Two coaches. You've got standing successful programs, and you've got emerging programs that are a little bit newer. You've got athletic directors of schools that sponsor the sport of lacrosse, and you have athletic. I think there's one of those athletic directors is at a school that doesn't sponsor lacrosse. So you get a lot of different perspectives and input, kind of a diverse group of input with that committee. I saw somebody, it might have been you, that said, it was John Losey actually that said, hey, I know a couple coaches that are going to pop into that meeting when they have it in January. I don't know if it works that way. I know with our association meetings, anybody's welcome.
Okay.
That's the case with the MHSAA. I would, before you start rolling in there, I would check with them. I really don't know.
It might have been, I think it was. It might have been Greg Durham over at St. Mary's that said,
might have been.
I'm available.
And I wouldn't be opposed to that. I just don't.
Yeah.
It would be a little different. But, particularly with regards to COVID protocols, I mean, I think the more knowledgeable people that we get to provide input, the better off we're going to be. So, I think the important thing is nothing was decided. We did have a motion on the faceoffs that we would have Rick write the language on it so that we had a starting place. But to my knowledge, in fact, I have an email from, I emailed Tom because I began to question whether, maybe I lost my attention span. But he said a few points of consideration. No final decisions were made, but the committee extensively discussed face-offs. So at the end of the day, I think we all hope that COVID will be gone. Maybe it will magically disappear and play lacrosse the way it's supposed to be played. Maybe we'll inject bleach in our blood and we'll all be virus free.
UV rays, just put a flashlight up our nose. Yeah,
maybe we'll have a vaccine. Maybe we'll have a vaccine that people will actually take. I mean, there's 100 different things. Is there really any value in making a decision in October of this magnitude when we don't start until March 9th? Or I know, actually start March 12th, I think it is. So, let's not rush to do it and let's find better alternatives. The goal is just to make sure that kids can play and play safe. Really the only way that we can do it. And everybody on that committee said, I don't think it is. I think we can come up with something better. But, you look at, go back to the conversation we were having about last spring. There were all kinds of plans out there. We just weren't communicating with them because they were changing every single day. I said, hey, we got to be transparent with this. We got to get it out there as a starting point because our members in the lacrosse community, they want to know that we're working hard well in advance. And I'll be the first one to tell you that if the only way that this rule change makes any sense whatsoever is if the only alternative is to cancel the season.
Agreed.
I know that there were a couple people, I don't know who they were, that said, hey, if this is the way it is, we don't want to play. And I'll tell you, as a coach and somebody that loves the sport and loves kids, the hardest thing I've ever had to do is go to those 2020 kids and say, it really sucks to be growing up in this particular year. And I can tell you, of the 17 guys that I graduated, if I'd have given them the opportunity to cancel their season or play under these BS rules, 100% they would have taken it. They would have done whatever they had to compete. And
you're right. And I, the funny thing is this had gotten, the genie had gotten so far out of the bottle with this. So Saturday, like I said, I'm down at Adrian. And there's a kid there, I think he was from Hudsonville, playing for Omnia. And when we were meeting with the coaches to plan everything, we said, okay, well, what are the rules we're running today? Because any one of these tournaments, you can do straight federation rules, you can do a running clock, you can do, you know, some college things. So the college restart is coming into the high school game now, where you don't have to give them 5 yards if you engage to delay a game, all that stuff. And so apparently the new college face-off that's coming is standing up and no more motorcycle grip. You've got to be underneath. And,
right.
You know, while, again, it was me and Bill and Josh, we were laughing that, you know, you got three guys. Josh is the youth rules interpreter. I'm a certified U.S. lacrosse officials trainer and observer. Bill's our assigner. We're all college NCAA NILOA refs, and we're going, I haven't been in the rule book in 6 months. I haven't even looked at what the new rules might be, because there's no fall ball that we've been a little lazy about not getting ourselves ready to go out and do college NCAA fall ball games. We're like, oh, I guess we're going to have to figure it out this weekend. So we got together with the coaches, and they said, I guess we're going to do the stand-up thing. And we don't know if that means your toes got to be inside the shaft, your toe can be outside. We just know that you can't have your knees on the ground anymore. And so as we're meeting with the face-off kids trying to explain this to them, the kid from Hudsonville says, hey, man, I don't care, standing, kneeling, whatever. I just know that they just canceled face-offs for my high school season next year. So what does it even matter? It was like, no, 16-year-old kid, we did not cancel the face-off. But it had gotten out there. And even though it's like, you know, when there's a misquoted story or a wrong story on Twitter, it gets retweeted 500,000 times, and then the retraction that says, no, we screwed up, is retweeted like 3 times. You know, it was one of those things where this had gotten out there, and it had spread through everybody. So I'm having to reassure this kid, like, I don't know if high school is going to go to standing up. I don't know if high school is going to do kneeling. But I can guarantee you that thing that you heard was the absolute last possible solution that we could come up with to make sure we still had a season. And the kid was relieved. He was telling his buddies, like, hey, guys, they didn't cancel the face-off. This is great. But
yeah, those, and it's interesting because, you know, me being the clever, you know, not so clever guy, I tried this to say, hey, I think if we're going to change the face-off, let's make it consistent with college, because this is a really tough year for seniors if we're going to have the ability to do the same rules as 2019. But they're preparing for, you know, to be able to have an opportunity to face off in college, which has a completely different set of rules. I really think in the face off, I wish they'd just come up with something and stick with it. But I'm sure you do as well. But I think we do those kids a disservice. You know, I'm really lucky. I have a kid right now that, you know, I don't know if he's the best in the state, but he's very good. And he works his tail off. I mean, he's really serious about the face-off. And he just committed to RIT in New York. You know, now he's got to spend a season doing the face-off in a way that he won't be able to do at the collegiate level. And I tried to say, hey, let's change the rule. Let's make it consistent with the college rule. It's not really that big a deal. But, you know, so –
I will say two things on that, Jim. As I was talking to these kids about standing up and where they put their foot and everything, one of the kids, and he was a kid from, I think, the Midwest Elite, or there was two teams there with the name Midwest in them. He looked at me and goes, why are we doing it this way? And I said, kid, I've been doing this game since 1989. I don't think the face-off has been broken since 1989. They keep changing it. I don't think it's ever been broken. I don't know. Yeah, it's probably a little bit better than it was in 1989, where we actually put the ball between the sticks like the girls' game before we actually had a gap between the sticks. But, you know, as the refs, everyone thinks that we're the ones that are screwing it up, or we're the ones that want these changes, and we're the last to know. We
right.
like the last couple of years with shot clocks and diving. You think we're the ones that told you to add a shot clock? We sure as hell are not the ones saying, oh, you can dive, but now you have to have this snow cone goal mouth above the goal line. Like, you guys figure it out and tell us. We'll officiate it. We'll adjudicate it. But I'm with you. Whatever they do in college, let's make sure it's the same way down through youth, so that it's this. We would never tell a guy that they can take a jump shot one way in high school, but they can't take a jump shot the same way in college. right? The difference between the aluminum bat and the wood bat in college to pro baseball is about all I can think of, where we change a mechanic or we change the way we do things. We don't tell them in football they can't have snaps under center or they have to go shot. Like, this is the only sport where we do that, and it just doesn't make any sense to me.
Yeah, so, you know, that's kind of the context of what happened. I feel bad that it did. I think the thing that I feel the worst about is there were a lot of people in the interest and the passion that they have for the game. They made some characterizations of people on the committee. And though I don't really care what people think of me, I think the world of some of the guys that are on there, the Mike Jollies of the world, the Rich Kimballs of the world, the Ricks. I mean, those three guys, right there have like 100 years of lacrosse experience. I'm pretty sure they're knowledgeable of the game. And it was
just Mike Jolly has 100 years of lacrosse experience by himself. The man is old.
Yeah. So
I'm teasing you, Mike. I love you.
For those people. And here's the view. I mean, they're all volunteer positions. So, you know, people that are just coming on and experiencing this for the first time are thinking, this might be a good time to get off of this committee. I don't really want to put myself out there. I mean, it's the social media stuff really isn't the bad stuff. You should see some of the emails I've received.
I believe it.
It's like, wow, really?
And I don't want to go too far down that rabbit hole because I probably know the people sending and receiving those emails. But, you know, I think the one thing that was interesting is you have clearly made it stated that when we regroup in January, we're going to have a lot of conversations before that. So just Thursday, Effinger and I talked for 45 minutes to an hour. And it was, he had already talked to Rashid because Tom reaches out to Brian as the rules trainer for US Lacrosse Michigan. Brian coordinates with Capital City, with the Grand Rapids officials, with David Gifferl up in Saginaw and the assigner up there. Like, Brian communicates with all those guys, so he's got his pulse on that stuff. And it's his job through US Lacrosse. Yeah, Tom, if you're going to make some of these changes, you're going to want to bring guys like us in the room. You know, I drove to Adrian on Saturday with Bill Schmidt, who's the local assigner for most of the states and every tournament that our kids play in. And he and I were talking about it. And well, you can't do it at goal line extended because then you just move two poles down to be on the ball. And now we're going to do a 10-man ride. And you know, who can sub? When can you sub? You can't give them a free clear. I'm not going to be pulling my card out because, you know, we have our little card to keep track right of alternate possession, timeouts, stick checks, that kind of stuff. You're going to wait after every goal for me to pull out in the race and switch? Like, no, we're going to need the basketball possession arrow thing. So this was posted on Thursday. And again, I've reffed Chris Garland's games where he's been at Country Day 2-3 times. I've shook his hand 2-3 times and said, hey, coach, are all your players certified and equipped by rule today? He's not a buddy. My kid doesn't play for his team, but he's not an enemy. He's not a guy that I'm trying to take shots on this, but he and I follow each other on Twitter. And when he posted this, I'm not attacking him for posting it. The way he read it and the way I read it was, you guys just got rid of our face-offs. What now? So, you know, I've been sharing this, but I'm not sharing this attacking Garland or picking on him. But you know, like I said, when this came out, from the moment I saw this tweet, I talked to you. Doug Jolly got a hold of me on behalf of his dad. I talked to Effinger. I emailed with Rashid. I spent 4 hours in a car with Bill Schmidt talking about it. I've talked to a bunch of other coaches and people this weekend. So you're right. The conversation is happening, and it's happening by email. It's happening over phones. It's happening on Twitter. I'm not a representative of Mishloa. I'm not a representative of any coaches or a referees association. So that committee, I think you do need guys like Brian Effinger in the room and get to the bottom of this as far as, you know, like you said, we hope COVID's gone. November 3rd. The voting happens. Hallelujah. We have the next president decided or who's going to serve the next 4 years.
It might take a little longer, just so you know.
I try to not be political on this, man. I really try. But to your point, yes. I really think that once we get through the election, some of this stuff is going to go away or be less talked about because people have agendas. I hope that we just get back to life and not have to wear masks to the grocery store and not have to have my kids sit in assigned seats on the bus. But I just want to have a lacrosse season and I want people to be safe about it.
Yeah, I don't, I, I didn't say I thought Chris did anything wrong. I think he just misunderstood it. I mean, Chris loves the game. He loves the sport. He's passionate about it. You know, I wish he would have called me and we could have talked live, but, you know, he's trying to protect the interests of all the kids that play lacrosse. I don't believe that he does it just for the Cherries. So I didn't mean to throw Chris under the bus. I think that there's a lot of people that reacted with poor information. And
I don't perfectly, think I don't think you threw him under the bus, just to follow up on that.
And to be perfectly honest, and I'm not faulting anybody, I'm not faulting Tom Rashid, but the minutes perhaps could be written a little bit more clearly.
I agree. The messaging is very important. And I'll say this about Garland. He posted this at 8:55 in the morning, and he's a high school teacher.
Yeah.
I have the ability in my office with my dual screens and my phone to be on a Zoom call, to be doing a training, to be selling, and pick up my phone and check Twitter, or to have it on a second monitor while I'm doing this. He doesn't have that luxury. So it wasn't like he saw this and spent the next 2 hours dealing with it like I did, because I had that freedom because I'm my own boss. But he's got 25 high school kids in front of him that he's responsible for.
Here's the good news is, however or whatever reason it started, we are already ahead of the game in terms of other potential solutions that we might be able to introduce, even if they're different COVID protocols. This is bad, but I got to believe that there are ways, with all of the minds that we have in the game, there are other ways that if we're in the same spot we're in right now, we'll have alternate plans that we can implement and still play lacrosse the way that it's meant to be played. This is a really good rule. We'll come up with something.
We've already seen it. Josh Pate this weekend had one of the new Fox 40 electronic finger whistles, because what the talk of is that if there is an issue, we would be able to have the officials with a mask and do a finger whistle for the face-off. Because really, the thing's loud enough that everyone can hear it. I don't think it's loud enough that everyone can hear it if you had full stand, screaming, yelling parents, state finals kind of stuff. But as far as just the two face-off kids and the two wing guys hearing it, no problem. So you bring up your mask, you set the ball, use the finger whistle, or you set the ball first and the kids come in after you, use the finger whistle and then back out. I mean, there's a lot of different options that we're already seeing available. And again, I reffed, like I said, 6 games. Yeah. Can't know how many hundreds of face-offs I did that day. I didn't worry about it. I mean, I'm outside.
And just to come back full circle, you know, and I'm not really defending the committee, but remember the language that we started with that one rule, is it's just, hey, we're getting rid of it except the first and third. And one of the conversations that we had is, what, does the virus not attack people on the first and at the beginning of the game and the beginning of the half?
Yeah. I mean,
if it's really unsafe to have a face-off, why are we even having them? And the intent was to say, well, this is a dumb rule. We got to do the face-offs.
Yeah. But
the response was, well, maybe you're right. Maybe if it's this bad, we will play the game with no face-offs. So we didn't go above and beyond what the NFHS was recommending. We said, well, how does this even make sense? I mean, how can the offensive and defensive lines play for a whole football game and practice all week, yet we can't do 20 times 7 second face-offs? It just doesn't make, it didn't make any sense to us then. And so, I think the other thing that we spent a lot of time on that I think is worth mentioning is in the football community, and I apologize, I don't remember the numbers, but there were a certain percentage of referees that opted out of reffing this particular high school season. And there's a couple of things that I think from a referee perspective, and I'm not a referee, but if any percentage of our referees opt out, we're going to be in trouble. I mean, we're already in trouble with the shortage of referees that we have.
Yeah.
The other thing is that, you know, the high school teams share athletes. I mean, there's a lot of multi-sport athletes. There's a lot of crossover with football in the player community. There is also that same overlap in some of the referee community. So as the MIAA and the GLIAC, and they play football in the spring, we may have a really dramatic shortage of referee availability, because some will have opted out, some will be coaching college football on Saturdays and Sundays, and we may have to look at that from a scheduling perspective. Well, we really can't afford to lose a whole lot of refs in our high school. And so we spent a lot of time on that. And that's when we said, well, wait a minute, we got it. We have to have the referees at this table. There's no way we can even make a decision without representation from the people that have to actually implement it to begin with. So, I mean, this wasn't a real long meeting, but it was long enough where you said, all right, we're not making a decision today.
Yep. All right. So we try to keep these to about an hour. I think we're right around there. I was texting with Chris. He was on the phone with a recruit, you know, his day job. So he just gets to miss today. I really thank you for jumping on and helping set the record straight. Sooner or later, we probably should have you on just to talk about your lacrosse career and life and how you got into it. You know, we were really good under COVID to get these, you know, we were doing three of these a week at one point, four of these a week at one point. That summer hit, we got back to our lives, and then we started doing them again. Then fall ball hit, and Chris's availability struck down. October's been a nightmare for me with Cub Scouts, lacrosse, family stuff, everything else. But I'm thinking in November, as we start to get November, December, January, we're going to try to get back on more of a calendar to talk to. And as I've always said, this is the U.S. Lacrosse Michigan podcast. We talk to men's, women's, boys, girls, youth, college, high school, officials, coaches, trainers, you name it. So any other parting shots or thoughts on this? Because I think we got the message out there that people, we did not get rid of the face-off. The committee is not made up of people that don't know about lacrosse. They do not hate face-off kids and are trying to ruin the game. Anything that we missed?
I don't think so. I really appreciate the opportunity to talk to it. Hopefully people will give it a listen and understand it. And here's the parting shot that I'd like to make. Have legitimate ideas that they want us to consider and put forth to the committee. If we could do that through email to anybody on that committee and say, hey, this is something that you might want to think of, or somebody that you want to talk to. I think everybody on that committee genuinely wants to have lacrosse in the best and safest possible way.
I'll even say this. Tom Ration has never been shy about sharing his email and saying, if you have something, call me. Talk to me. I've got Tommy's email. I've texted with Tommy before when I've had concern or issues about anything. He's really good about getting back to people, and he's not a lacrosse guy, but he's our lacrosse guy, and I think he tries really hard, and he's not going to make everyone happy. So email Jim. Hell, email me, president at michiganlacrosse.org. I talk to every one of those guys in that – well, not everyone, but most of you on that committee on a regular basis. And I talk to Effinger all the time, and he's going to be in the room, so – I'll give you my two cents. And if you do get rid of the face-off, well, then I'm going to give my 10-man ride instructions out there for sale. I've got a hell of a good 10-man ride that I think every coach is going to want.
Well, you know, John Paul has a YouTube video from when he was coaching at Michigan on the 10-man ride, and I really wanted to go see if there was a spike in views on that video, because it's really good. And I wondered, you know, if we actually were to do this, I mean, you'd have to 10-man ride. I mean, it would just be the standard operating position. And I don't know if John Paul feels the same way, but back then, I think he says it in the video. He says every high school team ought to be 10-man riding every time. That's how he kind of ran that club.
Yeah. And so that club team had so much success on that 10-man ride. I still remember the first time that he played Detroit Mercy inside at Ultimate Soccer Arena. They were waiting for it. Oh, yeah, he's going to do it. He's going to do it. Like, they were ready for it. He's going to do it.
Yeah, it's always easier. It always looks easy on paper. And then when you actually get into the game, it's like, that kid didn't understand it. Or he had to actually start from a spot on the field that he wasn't on the paper.
Yeah. So
it doesn't always work. But
and have to have an athletic goalie.
Yeah. Well, I appreciate the opportunity to clear the air. And, again, if people have ideas for January, get them on paper and send them to us.
All right. Next time we'll talk fly fishing. Next time we'll talk Grateful Dead. Next time we'll talk everything else. But thanks for talking committee tonight.
All right. Thanks.
Thanks, buddy.
at a quarter after nine. Could have been the Willie Nelson.